Let me start with a proper definition of generalized retract rationality. So let B be a commutative ring. Well, the usual kind of very good ring, commutative associative with one. Sigma is a subset of polynomials over B consisting of all polynomials such that f of 0 and f of 1 is invertible in B. And we define, basically we can take any functor on B schemes. And we define for any two points x and y in x of B, we define x is directly R equivalent to B to y. If and only if there is a point z of t of x of b of t sigma such that z of 0 is x, z of 1 is y. So the condition that the sigma consists of polynomials with invertible values at 1 and 0 allows to specialize z to 0 and 1, and we assume that these are our initial points. So
excuse me,
our equivalence relation.
Sorry, Nastya, I think there is something with your screen. We cannot see anything. Oh, yeah, now it updated.
Should I restart it? Maybe.
No.
Share it again?
No, now it seems to be okay.
Yeah, you probably could repeat all the. All the phrasing.
Now it seems to be okay. So just continue.
Okay, yeah, maybe now I switch to this window. So let me, like this is okay. So if I write now, can you see that something is happening?
Yeah, it is visible. Yeah, now it's okay.
Okay. The whole R equivalence relation on X of B is the transitive closure of direct R equivalence. So this is completely identical to the definition of Yuri Manin that he gave for algebraic varieties over a field. So if you assume that B is a field, then you get precisely his definition of R equivalence. Sometimes it is phrased a little bit differently. So sometimes people say that you take an open subset of a projective line or affine line containing two points, usually 0 and 1, and then you take home from this subset to your X, and whatever is the images of 0 and 1 and this map from this rational map from projective line, then these points are called R equivalent. So this is precisely the same thing that is written here. The only thing is to notice is that this B of T sigma, if you take it B to be a field, then it is just semilocalization of the affine line at 2 points 0 and 1. So this is precisely the usual R equivalence over fields. So this generalized R equivalence, so has, it has several good properties. So um, So first of all, it is functorial. So if B to C is a ring homomorphism, then we get a map. So here we don't have any groups yet because we take arbitrary scheme or even a functor. We get a map from X of B modulo R to X of C modulo R. If we apply it to product of schemes, so let's say X and Y are schemes, then X of B modulo R times Y of B modulo R is the same as X times Y over B of B modulo R. I will now switch to the next page. X is a group scheme, then also the, exactly as in the field case, X of B modulo R is a group. So it is a quotient by R, what we denote RX of one. So this is the equivalence, sorry. Well, RX of B. This is the equivalence class can you hear me? My earphones said something.
Yeah, everything is okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
No. Okay, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess, sorry, my earphones have discharged, I guess. So I will use the built-in microphone. So it is the equivalent class of one. More importantly, it satisfies the natural property that we expect, if you have an open subset of a fine line and it is principal or
affine line or affine space.
Affine space. Or B is semilocal, then this open subscheme has, since we do not know anything about B, we have also to require that let me write it like this. So U of B of modulo R is either a point or it is empty if there are no points inside this open subset. We do not require anything over B, so I have to make this second option. But if it has a point, then all points are equivalent. And here semilocality already comes into play, so we cannot prove it in general with this definition of R equivalence. One other property that may be interesting for the audience of this seminar, which is called, I believe, A1. What is it called? A1 homotopy, A1 topology, motifs, and K-theory seminar. So since it features A1 topology in the title, let me also write down that it is related to the naive A1 equivalence on the points. So what is naive A1 equivalence? This is a transitive closure of the similar relation of a direct A1 equivalence relation on points. X is directly equivalent to y, if and only if there is z of t in x of b of t, the base will stay b, such that z of 1 is x, z of 0 is x, z of 1 is y. So then we have also the set of E1 equivalence classes, of this naive E1 equivalence classes more specifically. And then this subjects onto X of B modulo R. And in some cases that I'm going to talk about for reductive groups, they are isomorphic. And it is important for establishing their properties. So some properties, in fact, are easier to prove for R equivalent, some properties are easier to prove for A1 equivalent. But on the other hand, so you may also say the following. So X of B of T, so this is also a very basic computation, that X of B of T modulo R is isomorphic to X of B modulo R. So in other words, you may consider R equivalence relation as an E1 invariant functor on the category of whatever is your category of B schemes or affine B schemes. So maybe also this will be useful for me. So I would like to say to give a proof which explains why we need semilocality, and from that point on I will I always assume that B is semilocal. So basically, it is a generalization of this property that if you have an open subset of an affine space, then it is R-trivial, right? So in fact, this holds a little bit more generally. So if G is a group scheme over B, U is an open subscheme. So we assume that U is principal and G affine, well, to make sense of a principal open, or B is semilocal. Then U of B modulo R injects into G of B modulo R. So together with the previous property, it precisely implies that responding statement for an open subset of an affine space. So let me start with the second case. And the principal open subset case is very similar, even easier. So the whole thing is an easy exercise, but I want to show why semilocality is important. So first of all, we note that X and Y in G of B are equivalent if and only if they are directly R equivalent. So I don't know if I should write it. I think maybe not. The point is that G is a group scheme, and the argument is very standard. You take one point equivalent to the second point, and second point equivalent to the third point, and you take the functions that provide these direct R equivalences. And if you take a suitable product with some inversion and some change of parameter, then you get the function which gives you direct R equivalence between the initial point and the terminal. So So here it matters that G is a group schema. So what matters if B is semilocal? B is semilocal. Yeah, so this fact that direct R-equivalence is equivalent to R-equivalence in this case, it allows us to, if we have two points which become R-equivalent in G of B, then we can assume that they are directly R-equivalent in G of B. So now we have X and Y in U of B such that X and Y are directly R equivalent in G of B. Then, well, as I by the definition, there is Z of T in G of B of T sigma. Z of zero is X, Z of one is Y. And we note the following thing, that this localized ring is the semi-localization of B of T. So it is itself semi-local, and it's semi-localization at the set of all ideals of the form, well, like what I'm writing.
I'm sorry, what is this sigma here?
Sigma is a set of polynomials which take invertible values at zero and one. So B of T sigma is basically a semi-localization of B of T at zero and one. Semi-localization of the affine one. Yeah, but if B is a field, right? So if B is not a field, so we have to be a little bit more specific. So it is a semi-localization at all maximal ideals of B of T of this form. Mi B of T plus T B of T, Mi B of T plus T minus one B of T, where M1, Mn are maximal ideals of B. So it is a semi-local ring with these maximal ideals. Then, since we know that X and Y are in U of B, then
I'm sorry, is it the first time where you get this sigma, or is it, was it in the definition?
Sigma. Well, sigma is the set of polynomials in B of T with invertible values at zero and one. Here, I show again the here.
Yeah. So this is a definition?
Yeah, this is a definition.
Whose definition is it?
Well, it's just a notation, Misha. I mean, it's not much of a definition. Sigma denotes the set of polynomials. If you mean, I mean, it's just a notation. So the definition is the definition of R-equivalence. The definition of R-equivalence, the way I write it here, you are seeing it, is our definition with Philippe Gille. But if you take B to be a field, then it is precisely Manin's definition of R-equivalence.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, I missed something. Okay.
Yeah, okay. So it follows that closed points of B of T sigma are mapped by Z into U. Then Z factors through U, since U is an open subset of G, and well, B of T sigma is semi-local. So Well, this is the explanation why a semi-local case works much better than general case for this definition. In particular, we have this injection. This injection, of course, makes you think about whether R-equivalence is birational invariant, as it is for certain classes of groups, in particular for reductive groups, over a field. Let me state it as a proposition. So here we just proved some injectivity. Yeah, okay, so from now on, I will always assume that B is always a semi-local affine scheme. I will not say it explicitly. So proposition. Assume that for any maximal ideal of B, B modulo M is finite. All residue field, infinite is infinite. So all residue fields are infinite. Let G be a group scheme over B such that it is unirational in the following rather strong sense. There is an affine open. There is an open subset of the affine space V, a B morphism F from V to G such that F B modulo M is dominant for any M, for any maximal ideal M. For any open subset U of G, which contains one, of B modulo R is isomorphic to G of B modulo R. So in other words, if G is unirational in this strong sense, well, I don't know if you consider it strong or weak, but let's say there is a morphism over B, which becomes a dominant morphism over every residue field and makes G unirational this way, right? Over every residue field. If this is the case, then our equivalence is a birational invariant of such G's, because we can just take an open subset U and the R equivalence class set is the same as the R equivalence class group of G. This condition of unirationality is satisfied in particular if G is reductive and linear over B. G over B is a reductive and linear, then it is unirational in this sense, consequently, G of P modulo R is a birational invariant for such G. So I would like to mention that, well, this has been long ago known over fields. And moreover, over fields, something more is known. In fact, R-equivalence is a birational invariant for smooth projective or even proper, let's say smooth projective varieties over a field. So this is a very nice and strong result by Bruno Kahn and Sujata Ramdurai, which is relatively recent, I don't know, within 10 years. Sorry, I forgot to write down the year. So over fields, it is a birational invariant in very strong and good sense. So the statement is for proper varieties, I think their initial statement. And then of course, you can deduce some things for affine varieties, which admit good compactifications and even in general, something holds. So we would expect our generalized R equivalence over semi-local rings also to have good birational properties. So far, we were just interested in the reductive group case. Here we have this result. So it is a little bit...
May I ask you a question? Mm-hmm. Is there any direct relation to some chow, I mean, to the group of zero cycles?
Over this general base, well, we just did not try to write it down, but over a field, yes, it is rather easy to see that R equivalence maps to A0, right, of the corresponding variety. If you take the difference of points, of course. So yes, there is a map.
So it's
I think over in over a general base, yeah, it should also work.
So and in general, it sits in between of A1 equivalence and this chow zero, right?
Yes.
Okay. And to which side it is closer? I mean,
I would say it is closer to E1 equivalence because chow is already kind of a linearization. It is closer to E1 equivalence.
At
least
it is.
Yeah.
So this R equivalence could be non-abelian, right?
For groups, you mean?
Yeah.
R equivalence can be the same as E1 equivalence, and even E1 equivalence can be non-abelian over non-local base, over non-local base. If you are asking about smooth local base, then probably it is abelian, but we don't have a uniform proof of that. So it's an empirical fact. So I'm not sure it has to be abelian for some deep reasons, let's say.
Okay.
Yeah. So let's come to retract rationality. Of course, it is abelian if you have the loop space of a group space, right, of a group scheme. So in this case, there is a natural reason why it should be abelian from the point of view of A1 homotopy theory, or at least its sheafification, probably. Here, I'm not so sure in general how it's supposed to behave. But in a priori for an arbitrary group scheme or group functor, yeah, there is no reason for it to be abelian, that it's not abelian in some cases where it may coincide with the whole group of points, in fact. So this equivalence relation can be void in the sense that a point may only be R-equivalent to itself. That happens, for example, for R-equivalence, no, it happens for A1 equivalence. Yeah, so
for
A1. For R-equivalence, it does not happen, but I don't think we have a good reason why it should be abelian. So here we have a better chance for it to be abelian, I guess. But yeah, I think I don't know. It really has to be abelian. Sorry.
Sorry, Nastya. I think that even over fields, there are no examples of non-abelian
equivalence. Yes, as I said, I one equivalence definitely doesn't have to be abelian. For our equivalence, yes, I think that's true. We don't know examples, but we don't know any. Do we know any serious reason why it should be abelian? So I don't know.
No, I don't think so.
Yeah. Okay. So in fact, I don't want to hypothesize too much, but of course, I think it may be helpful to prove new properties of R-equivalence over fields by using rings as well. So, okay. So, retract rationality. So, take a pointed B scheme. So, X is a B point. Called retract B rational if there is an open B scheme. V inside of A1 B and open neighborhood of X in X and two morphisms. This is phi, this is psi, and psi composed with phi is the density. So this is a generalization of rationality. It turns out that this property is very close to the property of being R-trivial. Trivial R-equivalence class set, R-equivalence class group. Lemma, which tells you why it should be the case. If U is a retract of an open subset of the affine space, then U of B modulo R is one point or empty if there are no B points there. Proof. Well, okay, let me, I don't want to really bother with the empty set. So let's say there is a point X here, then it is one point. The proof is that this is just functoriality of R equivalence. This is the identity. This is the identity. This is one point, as we have established. I remind you that from now on, I always assume B to be semilocal. Of course, U of B modulo R. So I'm sorry for proving these very simple things for you, but I want to make it a very explicit picture why things work the way they work. So, and now something that I'm not going to prove, or the proof is also not very hard. So namely, this is called Salkman's criterion of retract rationality. So Salkman considered it over fields. So if B is so in his 1984, well, I already said that B is in a local. If we have a finite number of maximal ideals, and X over B is affine integral of finite presentation. And X is a point of X, then X is retract B rational. If and only if there is an open neighborhood of X in X, such that U of B surjects onto the product of X of B modulo MI, all I 1 to K. Sorry, not X, but U. Okay, so so here I will not prove it, but the proof is not hard. Namely, what you have to do is you have to use the fact that X is finitely presentable, present it as a spectrum of well, it is affine also, so it is a spectrum of a quotient of a polynomial ring of the affine space, right? So it's a closed subscheme of an affine space. Then consider the sorry, I think I didn't write it correctly. Yeah. So it should be like this. So for any semi-local, so for any semi-local, here the maximal ideals of B are not enough. So we have to consider all semi-local B algebra C. And we need this, what Philippe calls lifting property, that U of C surjects onto the product of U of C modulo N for all maximal ideals N of C, for any semi-local B algebra C. So then you can use this fact, apply it to the field of rational functions of X, which is one of the residue fields of affine space. And since X is finitely presented, and then you will be able to construct the retraction of U onto an open of an affine space. So this is more or less how it is proved, not hard. But we use this criterion to, we can use this criterion to prove retract rationality of many group varieties. Let me now state the theorem. From our paper. So as usual, B is a semi-local ring. So G over B will be an isotrivial B torus, or G is simply connected a semisimple, of course, strictly isotropic. Strictly isotropic means that all semisimple factors of G have proper parabolic subgroups. Then the following conditions are equivalent. First, G1 is retract B rational. Second, G of C modulo R is 1 for any semilocal B ring C. Third, G of F modulo R is 1 for any B field F. And fourth, G satisfies this lifting property. So G of C surjects onto product of G of C modulo N for all maximal ideals of C for any semilocal B algebra C. Okay, so and this is in fact also a relatively easy theorem. So first of all, let me say that it has been known in the field case. So the case of torus is due to Colliot-Thelene and Sansuc, 1987 paper, principal homogeneous spaces under flask torus and applications. And the case of isotropic simply connected group is due to Philippe in his text on the Knezer-Tietz problem. So in the field case, this has been known. So in fact, it is it holds over semilocal rings. Not, it is not deduced from the field case. It just holds for the same reasons as in the field case. So for tori, you need to use flask resolutions. So of course, so what do we really have to prove? So one implies two trivially, two implies three trivially. Well, three implies four slightly less trivially. So, four implies one by Saltman's criterion. So the only slightly novel point is three to four, the implication three to four. So let me show this implication. So it is if G of F the R is one for any B field F, then G of C subjects onto this problem. So, of course, if G of F modulo R is trivial for every B field F, then it is trivial for every C field F, because it is in particular B field C is a B algebra. So for any semilocal B algebra C. So we can basically assume that C is B. So assume that T is a, well, G is a torus T and is a trivial torus. Then it has a flask resolution, which consists of a short exact sequence like this, where S is a flask torus and P is a quasi trivial torus. That is a direct factor of invertible torus. So then we have the following diagram. Well, let me keep C, since I already have C here. Right? P, in fact, is retract rational because it is a direct factor of invertible torus. So it is as a consequence, it satisfies the Saltman's surjectivity. So here we have surjective map always. If we know that, I guess I wrote something strange here. No one told me. Like this. So if we know that this is one, because this is our assumption that on fields, So if we know that T of C over N is one for any N, then we can prove that this map is also surjective. Then it implies that this map is also surjective. So this is how it works. The retract, why does it work like this? It works like this because, in fact, if we denote this by, pi, this projection, then pi of P of C will be precisely the R-equivalence pi of C of N. Will be precisely the R equivalence class of one in T of C of N modulo N. So this is about fields. C modulo N is a field, and this is a fact already present in the work of Colliot-Thelene and Sansuc. So for fields, it works very easily like this. And for isotropic groups, simply connected semisimple isotropic groups, it is also very easy because we know that on fields, G of F modulo R under these assumptions is isomorphic to the what I call the non-stable K1 functor of G. So this is a quotient of G modulo EP of F, where EP of F is the subgroup generated by UP of F. Well, here I don't have to fix a parabolic sum. let's say, modulo E of F, where E of F is the subgroup generated by all parabolic subgroups of G, just like this. Since this is isomorphic to the affine space, the unipotent radicals, we need to show the same surjectivity. So G of C surjects to the product of G of C modulo N for all maximal ideals N of C. And we know that G of C modulo N modulo R is one, right? So what does it tell you? It tells you that this is in fact isomorphic to the product of E of C of N over all N. Because our equivalence class group is trivial, so this is a group of point G of F is the same as this product, is the same of this subgroup E. Here we have surjectivity from E of C, because unipotent radicals of parabolic subgroups are isomorphic to affine spaces. So we have this surjectivity, and affine space, for example, is retract Russian. And since this one is a subgroup of G of C, so we get this surjectivity on top. So this is even simpler. So now we have proved this theorem. Let me go back to it. So it tells you that being retract rational for these two classes of groups is equivalent to being R trivial in this sense. For any B field F, R equivalence class group is trivial. Unfortunately, so far we don't know how to join these results together. Makes sense to assume that there is a certain joint result, right, for some reductive groups, maybe not exactly for all, but for the ones where derived subgroup and radical joined in a nice way, then there should be a general result that they are retract rational. But apart from the obvious case of direct product, unfortunately, we don't know how to join this result. So this is an open question, even over fields. So not just over rings, but also over fields. Theorem two, which is slightly more involved, the second theorem on this topic is the following.
May I ask a question regarding the proposition three and theorem four? Say, for tori over, we know the following reformulation of retract rationality, that a torus is retract rational if and only if it is a direct factor of a quasi-trivial torus. Do you have anything in your setup over semilocal rings?
Yes, for normal semilocal rings. Yes, this is true.
So it's also equivalent.
Yeah, so I'm going to state the results, which are for more special class of rings. So let's call it theorem five.
Oh, okay, thank you.
So assume that moreover B is a domain and K is a fraction field of B and G is a reductive B group such that either B is normal and G is a B torus, or B is equicharacteristic regular ring, and G is simply connected, semisimple, strictly isotropic. Then G is B, retract rational, if and only if GK is K retract rational. So this is reminiscent of many properties that hold for semi-local regular rings and relate the values of factors over semi-local regular rings with the values of on the fraction fields. So here we get the corresponding statement for retract rationality, or if you want, for R-triviality. So, and of course, behind the scenes are the corresponding surjections of R-equivalence class groups. There are surjections and there are injections. So in general, in fact, for semi-simple, simply connected isotropic groups, there is an underlying isomorphism of R under these assumptions. Let me write it down. So it uses another theorem. Where B is in theorem 5, and we are in the second case. G of B modulo R is isomorphic to G of K modulo R. So in other words, this functor is also birational, weakly birational, let's say B is just specifically semi-local regular domain, also in the second parameter, in the parameter B. And this holds because this is isomorphic to G of B modulo E of B, this is isomorphic to G of K modulo E of K. So let me be a little bit more specific. This is also isomorphic to G of B modulo A1 in this case. So the group of classes of naive A1 equivalents. And in fact, both these isomorphisms are necessary to establish this theorem. So I already explained why it is important to replace R equivalence with non-stable K1 functor, because it allows you to prove the Zaltman's surjectivity condition. And the isomorphism with naive A1 equivalence classes, which was previously known over fields, is also part of our work with Philippe. And it is also important because it gives you injectivity. So we know how to prove injectivity for this interpretation of the corresponding quotient group. And for R equivalence, in fact, we prove surjectivity. So it goes. So under these assumptions, we have isomorphism, but surjectivity part comes from the definition in terms of R equivalence, and the injectivity part comes from the definition of A1 equivalence. And K1 factors are necessary to imply retract rationality. So all these three interpretations are important to prove the second part of this theory. Torai, let me state maybe longer since Boris was asking, so I will state the long statement that we have for tori. It has more equivalent interpretations, the retract rationality in this case. So theorem. The toral case is more specifically like this. So B normal domain. K is the fraction field of B. Then the following conditions are equivalent. So first, okay. T is a B torus. T is a B torus. It will be automatically a quasi-trivial under the assumption, automatically isotrivial under the assumption that B is normal. We have the following equivalences. First, T is an invertible B torus. Second, T is one is retract B rational. Third, it is R trivial on fields. Fourth, it is R trivial for any semilocal B algebra C. Now 1 prime, 2 prime, 3 prime, 4 prime. The same for K in for TK over K instead of B. So you can use the known properties that the corresponding assumptions in the field case are all equivalent to prove it for semilocal normal rings. So I already showed how surjectivity implies how R-triviality on fields implies Zaltman's retract rationality criterion. There are only fields involved. So the proofs are exactly the same as in the field case. How to prove the corresponding properties related to the fact that the torus is invertible? Well, for example, which one should I? Well, let's say assume that T is invertible. We use the flask resolution. We know that S is invertible and H1 of, in fact, for any C H1 of S is 1 for any semilocal B algebra C. Then, well, we can view P to T as a an S torsor. So it follows that it has a section. There is a morphism from spec C to well, there is a well, there is an open neighborhood, let's say. Okay, there is inside T such that P to T splits over U. And it follows that well, this yeah, sorry, I did not prepare to tell this proof, so I'm a little bit recalling it. So but basically it goes as in the field case. So there is an open subset of T which is related to this open subset of the torus. Well, to the well, it is a torsor under this flask, initially flask component of this resolution, which is S. And it turns out that it is also invertible. So this open subset will be a retract of, well, the locally this torsor will be retract rational. And since P is also retract rational, we can deduce that T is retract rational, some open subset of T is retract rational, and then T is retract rational. So yeah, so sorry, yeah, maybe I will not try to write it precisely, but the idea is exactly the same as in the field case. So all these facts are proved as in the field case. Okay, so I think I should stop here. So please ask some questions, maybe.
Thank you. Are there any questions?
Yeah, thanks, Jack. If possible. So I want to ask some weak question. You have some results which are stated separately for torii, well, as a trivial torii, and the second case, semisimple, simply connected, strictly isotropic groups. So the question is, can you in some cases extend this to more or less general reductive group? Well, maybe under some assumptions by using, well, not flask.
Using what, sorry? We cannot hear you now. Hello?
Can you hear me now?
Not so well, but yes. So what was your suggestion?
Sorry, so I think that in your arguments you used fast resolutions for Torre. Then Colliot-Thelene in his Crelli paper extended the...
I think I know what you that you have in mind, that there is a certain two-step reduction of reductive group to corresponding semi-simple group, and it involves also quasi, it involves flask torus, right? Yeah, I think at some point I looked at this, kind of resolutions of reductive groups by Colliot-Thelene. Yeah, I looked at them, but I could not prove the corresponding results using them. So maybe I missed something.
Okay, so it's not.
I tried to do it. Well, the good hint that it's not an obvious problem is that Colliot-Thelene himself did not prove it, right? So it was a natural question known to him by the time, I think, already in the field case. And I think he did not prove it because probably it's not so easy. But it doesn't mean that somebody else cannot prove it, of course. Maybe I just didn't understand something.
I'm sorry, I possibly missed something. So your motivation to do this was to do something that Colliot-Thelene was not able to do, or is there mathematical
reason? In some sense, yes, but this is not related to retract rationality. So that's another problem that I did not mention today at all, but it is also related to Colliot-Thelene. So this was a right case of you. So the problem, which we were able in fact to solve more adequately, so without the separation of two cases of torus and retract rational groups, torus and simply connected groups, so the problem that we were able to tackle is the problem of specialization. So there was a question. It's even written on a paper, but it was informally known to Philip for our equivalence. That there was a following question. So I assume that
I have some problems with hearing you. Are you speaking into some wrong point? Maybe you should try redirect your...
Can everyone hear me?
Yes, now it's perfect.
Maybe there is a problem with internet connection. That's more likely, I think.
My impression is that you had... And we hear, and I hear, and there is a problem with the sound.
So let me state the theorem. So if we have a Henselian regular local equicharacteristic ring and G is a reductive group over this ring and K is the residue field, K small is the residue field and K capital is the fraction field of R, then we were able to prove that G of R, R is a bad letter, let it be A. Then G of A is on one hand isomorphic to G of K modulo R, and on the other hand is isomorphic to G of K small modulo R. So the question that was there before was to relate these two R equivalence class groups, which were defined over fields. And it turns out that this can be done by relating it through the local ring, through the R equivalence class group of the local ring. So the specialization problem was to build homomorphisms in this direction. And it was known for smooth projective varieties over Henselian DVRs. And it turns out that it holds even for Henselian local rings and for reductive groups, which are not projective. So this was the specialization problem. I don't know if Colliot-Thelene was really working on it, but in his recent survey on R equivalence, he mentions this question.
Was it already known that they're the same?
Was it what?
I mean, you say that these guys are the same, right? I mean, that they're isomorphic.
You mean the in this residue field and the fraction field case?
Yes, yes.
It was known before for well, actually characteristic, well, even characteristic zero, characteristic zero Henselian DVRs, something like that.
Okay.
Yeah. So characteristic zero was specifically invoked for reductive groups. For projective varieties, it is due to a color that there is isomorphism for any Henselian DVR. There are isomorphisms like that. And this is, in fact, well, the characteristic case of this statement was used by Bruno Kahn and Sujat from their paper. So this was used in their paper, essentially. The projective case, of course, I mean. So not something specific about reductive groups, but the corresponding statement in the projective case. Okay. So this is the problem which really comes from the field case and which can be handled using the R equivalence over semilocal rings.
If the above isomorphism is specific to reductive groups, I mean, you can ask for any non-smooth.
Well, no, they are not specific. They are, I mean, for DVRs, they are known more generally for proper, I think it was even proper smooth, well, schemes over A, let's say. And for reductive groups, initial proof of Philipp of this isomorphisms, it involved compactification. That's why it did not go too far. It really needed the DVR assumption, because compactifications are constructed under over DVRs, I think. I don't know, but I think over DVRs only. Well, there were several reasons, but in particular this. And here we don't use compactification. So we prove it directly using the definition of R equivalence class group. Plus, of course, there is a very substantial ingredient, which I did not mention, because in fact, I gave a talk on this specialization problem separately in summer. So I didn't want to repeat myself on it. So there is a very important ingredient there, namely the Sergrotendieck conjecture. And that's why the ring is assumed to be equicharacteristic. If Sergrot and the conjecture were known for non-equicharacteristic regular local rings, then this statement would also hold for not necessarily equicharacteristic Hinzelian regular local rings.
Are there any more questions?
So you prove something for semi-local rings just because you can do this, or is it some natural level of generality?
Well, for this problem of specialization, it is a natural question because the question was to relate invariance of the group over the residue field of something and over the fraction field of something which is local. There are technical restrictions why many of our lemmas do not hold apart from the semi-local case, or maybe we have to be stated differently and proved differently in the non-semi-local case.
So the initial goal didn't include such semi-local in the formulation. This is just where...
No, the initial goal, of course, was more general in the sense that we would like to have to functors on the whole category of schemes, let's say, over something, which behave like R-equivalence. And we have these functors. The problem is that we just cannot prove much in the non-semi-local case. So it goes. For example, it is very helpful that quasi-trivial tori have trivial cohomology on semi-local rings. So this also helps to prove some statement. For reductive groups, there are the reasons why semi-local rings. Let me try again to answer briefly. We define our equivalence over arbitrary base, and I think it makes sense to do so. But unfortunately, geometry becomes very complicated over general base. So over semi-local rings, geometry is still rather transparent in terms of how our equivalence behaves. Yeah. So that's why most of our statements are over semi-local rings. But for you, maybe that's too simple. Maybe you can do something over an arbitrary base.
So I'm thinking whether it makes sense to extend generalizes just a little, probably not really. Thank you.
Well, I think it makes sense to generalize it for the simple reason that Alexei mentioned, is that because it's closely related to E1 equivalence and Chow groups. It is between A1 equivalence and Chow groups.
I'm just afraid that I cannot prove anything really exciting. Thank you.
Another related question. So you said that it is between naive and A1 equivalence and Chow zero. And what about non-naive and A1 equivalence? Can you anyhow relate it?
Well, there are statements proved by Asok, Hoyois, and Wendt, and by Balu and Savant. There is something there that I don't quite understand, honestly. So it behaves a bit complicated. The relation definitely is there, but it's a bit complicated. So for example, we know that if G is simply connected, not necessarily isotropic, and if K is a field, then pi 0 A1 of G of K is G of K modulo. If G is moreover fixed isotropic, Then it extends in the following way. So pi zero a one of G of R is the same as G of R is a bad letter, sorry, of A is the same as G of A modulo R for any semilocal regular equi characteristic ring A. So in the isotropic case, and this is the naive A1 equivalence also. So the naive A1 equivalence is also called Karubi-Villamayor K1 functor. And this is, yeah, this is also G of A modulo A1. A is also a bad letter, sorry. If G is an isotropic, then this is no longer true. So if G is an isotropic over a field, then G of K of X is the same of G of K, that is G of K modulo A1 is just G of K. So it's not the r-equivalence. They do not cancel. Already overfit. There is no reason why over semilocal rings they should cancel. Although here there may be some more subtle, so it's not always true that the group is A1 invariant, the points are A1 invariant in this sense, probably. But we are not very confident. Anyway, definitely A1 equivalence does not coincide with R equivalence. So the relation is more subtle. Here I don't know the precise statement. At a level of really of points, yeah. But that's what we know, I guess, by now. So simply connected groups. For Torei, definitely they do not coincide because Torei are A1 rigid, right? So this, so T is a torus. Then T of A of X, is T of A, all right? So, and that equivalence is non-trivial. So they do not cancel. Yeah, okay, yeah.
And does it mean that this R equivalence is closer to non-naive equivalence? I mean, does it have a map from, I don't know, from R equivalence to non-naive stuff?
I think it is written in one paper of Asok, maybe Asok with someone, but honestly, I forgot. I think yes, there is a map. Basically, because naive one admits a map, naive A1 equivalence, you have this map. So G of, which holds over an arbitrary base. So G of, let's say, as I wrote, G of B modulo A1 suggests on G of B modulo R. So I think it follows that there is a map from non-naive A1 equivalent. For some functorial reasons, but honestly, and because this is also, it is in A1 invariant function, as I mentioned. So yeah, I think there is a map, but honestly, yeah, I forgot the specifics, yeah.